area, and stop, how far do you have to travel to get to church?
Sometimes 2 minutes is the traffic's better.
He lives across the fence on the back side, all right? So if we put a gate in, it would be shorter. He wouldn't have to climb over, all right? Thank you guys for sharing with us today. Your microphone was on, but you may be seated and watch the screen.
Hi, New Hope. Welcome. We're glad to see you here. If you're a visitor with us, we would love to have you fill out one of the Connect cards in the pew right in front of you. We want to get to know you a little better. Now, we promise we're not going to call you on the phone or show up at your house at awkward hours in the evening or anything, but we just want to get to know you and send you something in the mail to help you know a little bit about us. Because our goal here at New Hope is to compellingly communicate to everyone whom God provides us the opportunity to serve the all absolute sufficiency of Jesus Christ who meets our every need.
One way that we compellingly communicate the all sufficiency of Jesus Christ to our youth is that we send the 4th, 5th, and 6th graders up to camp. They'll be leaving this Friday, coming back on Sunday, so keep them in your prayers. There's 14 of them, and there's 3 counselors, and they even have a little bit of snow now that they didn't have before, so hopefully that'll stick, and they'll be able to have some fun up there.
If you're looking for areas to serve here at New Hope, I've got great news for you. Today, out in the pavilion, our deacons ministry are out there at a couple tables, and they're there to help you find where you want to be. We have a few areas, like right now they're highlighting, areas you can help with all the events that we have going on at New Hope during the year. Like we have Easter coming up, Mother's Day, we have Harvest Fest in the fall, and we always need help with decorating, setting up, or taking down tables, so they can walk you through that and see if that's an area where you would like to help out. There are many other areas, so any place you want to serve, go out and speak with them and they should be able to help you. Also, I don't know if you're aware, but New Hope has an app. Yes, there's an app for everything, even New Hope. Now, that might sound exciting, but you might not have any idea how to use that app. So we also have a table out at the Deacons Ministry with lovely Tiffany Jones, who would love to show you how to use that app.
We have some spots open on the Elder Board, so if you've ever been interested in becoming a church elder, or you just want more information on what it means to be an elder, come to the class that's on February 4th during the 10:45 service with Rich Smith, and he'll give you all the information you need to know, and you'll get some idea of whether it's something you'd be interested in serving in.
Here at New Hope, we are very lucky, ladies. We've got a lot of Bible studies available to us. On Tuesday nights, Nan Isom leads a Bible study. On Wednesday morning, we have 2, and they are led by Tina Brown and Diana Rood. And we also have small groups available to us. If you want to be involved in any of those, the information for them are in your bulletin, or you can call the church office. But one that's particularly exciting to me today, because we're celebrating our first anniversary next week, for a year now, we have had an online Facebook Bible study led by Corey Gallardo. Now, if you're currently not on Facebook, but would love to read these posts, call Angel at the office and give her your email address, and she can forward you the post each week. You just won't be able to comment or read other ladies' comments. So again, if you want to be on this Facebook Bible study, just send me a friend request, Bond Boss, and I will gladly put you in that group. And the very following week, you will see the post show up in your newsfeed.
It's that time of year again, and the Mexico mission trip is coming up. The problem is the deadline for paperwork on this is tomorrow night. So get all the information that you need in by tomorrow night. If you have any questions, ask Pastor Chris, either by text or phone or Facebook or Instagram or whatever it is that you communicate with Chris on. Just contact him if you have questions. All of the information is online, so all the paperwork can be done online, but it needs to be done pretty quick. So Mexico mission again. It's exciting to see what God's going to do with that group of youth that go. On February the 18th, we have a group called His Little Feet coming to New Hope. And this is a group of kids from Haiti, from India, and from Kenya. And they'll be leading worship, and it'll be a great experience for a lot of people to come and just see what these kids are doing. There's some testimonies from the kids and a lot of dancing and singing. So come along, it'll be a lot of fun for the whole family. It's free, and there'll be some stuff for sale from the countries that they come from too. So just come along, it'll be interesting, it'll be fun. And that's on Sunday evening, February the 18th at 6 p.m.
Again, thank you for joining us today. We're so glad you're here. Now, let's all give a big welcome to our senior pastor, Tim Rowland.
That wasn't big enough. Just kidding. First time to do that. That's kind of fun, huh? Yeah, don't look so excited about it. Work and worship, all right? I don't want you to panic that you missed it, all right? It says January on the little thing in the bulletin. That's actually February the 23rd. So don't think you've missed it. This is a seminar. It's a one-day event. Contact Mark Gaddis if you're interested in being a part of it. This is a great way to give you ideas about how to take your faith into the workplace, all right? Work and worship. Your view, your attitude about your work, as well as taking your faith into the workplace. So I hope many of you who are engaged in business will find your way to attend that workshop that day. So contact Mark Addis if you would please. Tonight, 6 o'clock, services are here after church as normal. They're participating along with the Sunday morning series and our small group Bible study series on open doors. And you know, we talk about the 8 o'clock service being the no-frill service. They up their game. They have a frill we don't have. Pastor Mark made two doors and painted them bright yellow and bright blue, and they're on the stage over there to go with a series of opened and closed doors. So they've outshined us recently, all right? But anyway, they'll be pursuing that tonight. If you're not part of a small group, it's great to come on Sunday night, get a taste and flavor of it. By the end of that series, you can decide to join a small group if you would like. So love to have you at 6 o'clock tonight. For those of you who are not participating in that, tonight at 5 o'clock is the last of the 21 days of prayer and fasting evening services. For 21 days, folks from congregations all over the cities of Fresno and Clovis have been meeting together for the purpose of worship and prayer together. Tonight is the closing celebration of that. The goal was greater unity within the body of Christ for more significant impact for the kingdom of God in our areas. I'll be sharing a small part of that this evening along with several other pastors. Would love to have you out from 5 to 6. It is at the church called Cornerstone in downtown Fresno. How many of you remember the old Wilson Theater? That's where Cornerstone Church is. How many of you don't remember the old Wilson Theater? Okay, do you know where Warner's Theater is downtown? It's one block sort of westish. Sort of west, yeah, because the streets don't run normal there, all right? So it's kind of to the west, all right, from there. And it still says Wilson Theater on the big sign, and it also says Cornerstone. And that will be from 5 to 6 o'clock tonight. We'd love to have as many of you as possible come join us for this closing celebration. And I want to say a big thank you to all of you who made it, all right, over the last 21 days to some of those services. It has been a wonderful time for us to get better acquainted. I have been handed more prayer requests today than ever, I think. So let me give you a few updates besides those that are in your bulletin that you could read about. Beth Mitrovich has been attending our church just for a short time, but this past week she was in the hospital because she had a stroke. She went home yesterday. Mark had the opportunity to visit with her this week, and she has requested that we pray for her recovery. River and Kinsley. That's a 2.5-year-old and a 1-year-old. They're back east, and they are relatives of my sons of Highland, my son's mother-in-law, and they both are, as a result of this flu and with the temperature, are running seizures along with this flu. And so they have requested prayer. Let's see here. A young man in our 8 o'clock service requested prayer for his mother, that she would gain strength from her illness. Doug Crouch is a cousin to one of our 8 o'clock regular attenders. He is having surgery this morning as we are worshiping. He has stage 4 cancer. He has tumors in his lung and his brain, and the swelling and the size of that tumor in the brain has prompted seizures and bleeding. And so they are doing surgery today to try to stop the bleeding and give him some relief from all of that. So those are some additional ones to pray for. While we were in Oklahoma this past week, we found out 74 people have died in the state of Oklahoma from this flu. It's been so bad there, they closed schools down in most of the metropolitan areas on Thursday and Friday disinfected the campuses, and they hope with a four-day break might be able to bring down what's going on. Friends of ours that we were with there also had developed the flu in a pretty serious nature. So watch out, be praying for each other. If you have to cough, don't turn your face to the right or left, all right? So be very cautious as you are here today, because it has become very, very serious. On a lighter note, Chick Passarello, would you stand up for just a brief moment, please? I know he is standing. Yes, I know. Chick, your note is coming. All right. Chick, today, this very day, is celebrating his 85th birthday. 85. That's awesome.
I'd like everybody to pray for Shelly because she can battle the flu.
Okay. All right, very good. Well, she's put up with you for a whole lot of years, so she'll be able to handle this flu very well. 53 years. Outstanding, Jay. Thank you, buddy. Happy birthday. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings while they're doing that. Anybody in this service, you're going to Africa and you're leaving with me next Saturday. Would you stand up? Anybody in this service that's headed to Africa? All right, Mark is in the back. All right. All right, very good. There's eight of us going. It was in your bulletin last week. We will be leaving Friday afternoon for San Francisco. About this time next week, we will be in Brussels, Belgium. All right, meeting up with the rest of the 62 or 64 who are participating in this year's trip. And we'll be catching the flight then together out of Brussels to Abidjan, Ivory Coast, or Cote d'Ivoire. And we will get in there at somewhere around 9:30 or 10. We'll get to bed about midnight or 1. And we will be up at 5:30 to board a bus for about a 15-hour bus ride to the village of Europo. All right? So while you all are enjoying the Super Bowl, we'll be traveling. And then we'll be ready to start on Tuesday, all right, with all of the activities, the surgeries, getting set up for Kids Fest in the little village of Neona that we have adopted to start our building project there this year. So please be praying for your team from New Hope as well as the team from North America as we share in our 2 weeks of ministry in Ivory Coast. Let's pray. Our Father in Heaven, we love you. We thank you so very, very much for the privilege of being your child. Father, thank you that your love for us is not dependent upon our status in life. It's not dependent upon how many days, weeks, months, or years that we have been your child. Your love for us is not dependent upon our social status or our financial abilities. Your love for us does not increase or decrease because of our lack of education or the acquisition of a great deal of education. Your love for us is unconditional. You loved us so much, you sent your son loved us so much, he gave his life, and you love us so much that you continue to pursue us to the very ends of the world, to the very last breath of our life. And Father, thank you for the privilege of sharing life with you, of walking through the experience of daily living, knowing that within us is the mystery of godliness. That's how Paul described God in you, Christ in you. It's not only the hope of glory, but it's that mystery that Old Testament believers in you didn't ever experience or fully understand. That once forgiven, after Jesus Christ paid a debt he didn't owe and paid a price that we could never afford to pay, that we now have his presence in the person of the Holy Spirit living within us, providing for us all that he is, for every little thing, every big thing, every mundane thing, every serious thing that we face in life. And we give you thanks for that today. Father, forgive us for the many occasions that we have neglected this mystery of your presence in us. And we've tried to do life all on our own. And Father, I hope we'll recognize the many open doors that you set before each of us. The most quiet one in this room
the most shy one in this room. The one who is most easily intimidated. Everyone in this room, you provide open doors that you invite us to walk through with your presence at work in us, to share, to demonstrate, to give testimony to reveal in the way in which we live that you are a God who loves them and wants a relationship with others just as much as you wanted a relationship with us. So, Father, I pray that we who have no courage will use your courage. We who maybe don't have all the best words strung together in a sentence will allow you to work through our minds and our lips and become the walking advertisement of your deity in the world in which we're a part of. We trust you with the needs that have been expressed here today, from those needing strength as they're recovering from surgery or illness, to those who are as yet undetermined what's going on in their world. Thank you that you're big enough for the task. However you want to use us to be of encouragement and hope, may you find us ready, willing, and available. Father, thank you for our team of young people today leading us in worship today. Thank you for the gifts that you've given to them. Thank you for their availability to let those gifts be used in your fellowship, in your ministry. We're so grateful for them. For those who are absent from us today and would normally be here, thank you that though they're not here with us, we know that you are with them, and that gives us great comfort. For the privilege of giving and sharing today, may we give generously. Because you have given so generously, we give, Father, with a glad heart, not grudgingly. In fact, you tell us, hold on to it until we can give generously and hilariously, as one translation says it. It is so much fun to give to you, to see what you do with what little we can share, how much you do with it. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And watch the screen, please.
Work. Most of us spend over half our lives at work. Whatever it is you fill the 9-to-5 with, planting crops, building cars, taking care of patients, teaching students, or running a business, work is where most of life happens. For some, work is a drain, but a dread not in mornings. Forcing themselves to struggle through because they need the paycheck, while many times feeling trapped and beaten down by their job. Some people love their work, they're good at what they do, it energizes them. It's a place of security, a place to chase dreams, desires, and success. At work, they find fulfillment. We often forget to connect our faith to our work. We don't consider the reasons God may have us at our job. We don't think about the purpose and meaning we can bring to our work. We simply focus on how it makes us feel. But what if we saw our work as an opportunity to worship? As Christians, we are called to serve Christ with our lives. For a few, that means working as a pastor, a youth minister, or a missionary. Others serve the church by teaching children or singing in the choir. But when Sunday is over, most of us return to our jobs outside the church. For us, our mission is in the marketplace. We may not be the kind of missionary who moves to the far regions of Africa, but around the conference table, around the water cooler, or around the cubicle, we have an opportunity to worship the God who created us. He gave us skill. He gave us passion. He gave us work. When we do our jobs with excellence and integrity and diligence, it's an act of worship. We are displaying God's craftsmanship to the non-believing world around us. We are earning the right to be heard. We don't see a divide between Sunday and Monday, between the sacred and the secular. We've been invited into parts of the world that a pastor or tradition missionary would never see. We have conversations with people who would never set foot in a church. Whether we love or dread our work, we choose to turn the focus away from ourselves and towards the mission God has for us. Church is not the only place we worship. And Sundays are not the only days on our calendars that have meaning. Every day on a mission for God brings us great joy. Like the heroes before us, we can be modern-day Noahs and Josephs and Peters who are called For us, work is worship. On February 23rd, 2018, over 2,000 churches across the country are hosting the first ever Work as Worship retreat. Please join us and other business leaders from your church and community. Speakers will include Patrick Lencioni, Matt Chandler, Joe Mangy, Phil Fisher, and many more. Tickets are only $25 at www.workasworshipretreat.org. We'll see you there.
Guys, great job today. Going to Africa, we would like to take some letters with us. Many of you, 30-some-odd of you, in fact, 40-some-odd of you, as I'm being informed up here, 40 of you have helped adopt children in the village of Neonen so that they can continue their education through high school. And you've already sent your sponsorship in for them for this coming year. It's around 400 and, how much is it? 585. That takes a student, it clothes them, it feeds them, it buys their books, and it gives them transportation on a bike, 7 miles each direction, twice a day, and $585 sponsors that child to finish a high school education. And so we started this 3 years ago. We are following this class from their seventh grade all the way through their high school. And less than 10% of the children who do the elementary program in the bush of Africa and even in the metropolitan area of Abidjan, only 10% of elementary kids pass the test to go on to high school. And yet the village of Neonen, where Madame Elise is, and that's what prompted us to adopt this village, she by faith walked her way and found this village, started teaching the kids, and the first year that her group of kids took the exam to go to junior high, 100% of them, all their students passed the exam, and they're going on to school. So we are so excited to be a part of that. I believe everybody has their picture now. I think I just delivered the last one during that last song. If you would like to write a letter to your student, we will take it with us and hand deliver it to them. They don't have mail where they are. Okay? So that's why it makes it hard for you to hear from them. But if you have a letter you would like to send to them, we will deliver it. We'll deliver it to them the first couple of days that we were there. They do their best to get a letter written back. They have a little bigger process. We write the letters in English. They have somebody interpret for them, all right, in their language. For some it's French. For some it is Lobi, which is the dialect of their tribe. And then they will write a letter back in Lobi, and somebody else then has to translate it back so that you can understand the letter that you're going to get from them. All right? So we can't guarantee that you'll get a letter back, but they do their very best. All right? So have those here at the office by Wednesday late afternoon, if at all possible. As you know, we're involved in a series of open doors, of all the places to go. What doors are open? What doors are closed? It's the Sunday night study. It is also our small group study. I want to tell you a story this morning to see if I can maybe make this whole idea of open and closed doors, I don't know that I'll make it more understandable for you, but maybe it'll give you a sense of connectedness to what this is all about. I want to take you back to the year 1964. Actually, I'm going to take you a little farther back than that. I'm going to take you to 1959. There was an older couple, late 60s to 70, who bought a little country house off of Peach Avenue. This is when there was great distance still between Fresno State and the city of Clovis. That was all open country. And when this older couple moved into that home, they recognized that right next door was an empty little church building. The grounds were overgrown, the building was deteriorating, it wasn't much to look at, it was empty. That older gentleman called another man who had planted three churches before. And they called him and said, hey, I think you need to come look at this property next door to where I live. I think it would be a great place for you to restart a church. Plant a new place. That man came and looked at it. He went to the city of Clovis. He said, what's the problem with the property? And they said, well, it was closed down because they could not pay their taxes. There was only three or four people meeting there. We hold the deed to the property for back taxes. The gentleman said to the city fathers of Clovis, if you'll give me 6 months and the keys to the building, we'll pay the back taxes. We'll get something healthy going in this location again. City father said, okay. A church got started in 1959. And from 1959 to 1964, it was a place of steady growth. The first Sunday, I think that church met, there were 24 or 25 people met that first Sunday. 5 years later, it's standing room only. Now understand, standing room only at that church at that time was about from here to that wall and about seven rows deep. That's all it was. One big pew in the middle, side rows, a little stage. And a very, if you think our foyer is tiny, that one was really, really tiny. The biggest event that had happened in that church in years had been the Australian Shepherd Collie mix mother having 14 pups under the front step. That was the most life that had taken place in that church in several years. And so 5 years go by, the property is in much better shape. It is vibrant. It's got life in it. People are being saved, and the church is growing. Remember, this is 1964. It gone from 24, 25 to 140, 150. The man who planted that church there gets a call from the denomination he's connected with and says, we've seen your success in planting churches. We have a problem area in Roswell, New Mexico. This Baptist denomination wanted to be the first ones to have an outreach to aliens. Those of you who know the thing about Roswell, you know what I'm talking about, all right? This is not illegal aliens, all right? This is, yeah, out of work. And anyway, so they said to the son, we'd love for you to go there and plant a church. We believe in your track record. Open door, closed door. What is that? It looks like an open door, doesn't it? Yeah. So, much prayer, much thought. One of the shortest fundraising ever in the history of that denomination for a home missionary. Just a matter of months, funds were raised. And the Lonnie Rowland family left Clovis, California. And we moved to Roswell, New Mexico. I was 9, my sister was 14. With great sorrow, we left Clovis. We stopped out at Newberry Springs with fried chicken and cry as we had dinner that Sunday evening in the deserts of California. We found our way to Roswell, New Mexico, and Dad began to circulate in the community, found a building to meet in, and it needed work, it needed to be painted, it needed to be cleaned, and he began to get word out, such and such a church opening such and such a day. What he discovered very quickly was every time he mentioned the name of the church, the denomination, people laughed, snickered, ridiculed. You see, what the denomination had forgot to tell my dad was that they had tried to plant a church there the year before. But the pastor ran off with another man's wife and they took all the money from the treasury. In the town of Roswell at that time, it was front page news. And so every time that denominational name was mentioned, it was met with derision. Open door, closed door. After about 6 weeks, Dad realized that this was not a time for this group to open a church in that community. And he called the headquarters and says, you need to wait a minimum of 5 years till people forget what had happened. Wish you had told us. We packed up, we came back home. It was ginning season, so Dad had that as a fallback. He went to work. Mom had worked there as well. She went back to work. That 70-year-old man who had moved in, or 65-year-old at the time man who had moved in to that little country house in Peach was my mother's father, grandfather. He's planted between 30 and 40 churches in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s between Oklahoma and California. At the age of 70, he decided he wasn't too old to plant one more church. And he decided I'll plant one in Madera right after the first of the year. Mom and Dad thought, well, we're not tied up anywhere, we'll help them. Open door, close door. January 28th. What's today? My grandfather just visited his son, my uncle, on Belmont off of Clovis Avenue. Driving back towards Clovis Avenue, grabbed his chest. His car veered off into the grape vineyard, and he died of a massive heart attack 1 week before he was going to open first services at this church in Madera. Open door, close door. Over the next few weeks, after the service is over, everybody's catching their breath again. A couple of folks call Dad and say, we're sort of churchless at the moment. We don't know where to go, what to do. You thought about starting one in Fresno. In the trunk of my grandfather's car was a box of hymnals. They were green paperback books. Some of you have seen them around here about 20 years ago. We did a few services, you know, traveling out on the street doing caroling, and we would use those books to sing out of. And my dad looked at that box of books, and I think he had also a box of Bibles in the trunk of his car, and said, you know what, Madera is probably not the place for us, but in the 509 American Legion Hall on First Street, with the smell of whiskey, bourbon, and beer on the floor after the party the night before, Memorial Free Will Baptist Church got started. That became a church that I grew up in. That later became known as Ashbrook Church. And 25 and a half years ago, that is the church that merged with New Hope Church right here. Without the Roswell experience, we wouldn't be here like this today. And yet, through that whole process, do you see some of the confusion? Open door, close door. Should Dad have gone to Roswell? Did God punish him because he missed? Because he went 6 weeks? Cost a lot. And then just to side note, the ethics of Dad. Dad paid every dime back to the denomination, though he didn't have to, for moving expense us both ways, since it didn't work out. So this whole thing of open door, closed doors is sometimes not the easiest to figure out. So that's why we're going to take a closer look at this. And I'll just give you a heads up. This series is not going to end when the Bible study ends, because this subject has captured my interest. And there is so much here. We're going to probably be here till Easter. All right, just so you know, we're going to be talking about this whole idea of open door. I don't mean continuously from now until Easter. I'm going to let you go home today. All right? But we'll be in this series. I saw Dad look at his watch as soon as I said that. So here's two passages of scripture I want to toss out at you today to add to your thinking. And you know, some of you might be here and you're not a Christian. You're thinking, ah, well, I don't need to come back to this church until after Easter because I'm not going to talk about anything that's going to... You know what? This very well may be your open door to finding Christ. As you watch and listen and share, as we grapple. You see, everything about being a Christian is not all black and white. It's not all clearly defined. We often act like it is and talk like it is, and you think we think it is. Folks, it isn't. This Christian life is it's a messy journey. It is. And the thing I want us to discover, I think, most of all as we go through this journey, I think the biggest mistake that we have with open door and closed door things is doing nothing. We just simply sit because we're unsure of what to do. I think the biggest thing I want us to learn is that what God would love to see from us is obedience. It's just, don't worry about anything else. If this seems to be, if you pick the wrong door, you're not going to end up with the bummer of a gift. See, if leaving Clovis Church in 1964 and going to Roswell was a closed door that Dad thought was open, God did not punish him for it. God retracted because what he loved most of all was a willingness to go. Too many times God tells us to go and we just stay. So here's two contrasting scriptures that I want to throw out at you. One is found in Revelation 3:8. It's one we looked at last week. I know your deeds. See, I placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, that you've kept my word, and you've not denied my name. Then in the book of Acts, you know what? I didn't write the chapter yet. I just wrote the verse. I think it's 24. Yeah, chapter 24. Of the book of Acts, verses 22. This is the story of Paul the Apostle. He's been arrested by Felix, okay, who's sort of the governor of the area. Felix is a guy who likes popularity. So he tries to make everybody happy. So he's arrested Paul because the Jews are a little unhappy with him. So he arrests Paul, but yet there's something about the way Paul speaks and talks and does things, and he kind of likes Paul, and he's very familiar with the new Christian thing that's popping up in his region, and this whole explosion of the church, he's familiar with it, and so he's a politician, he's trying to straddle the fence. And then we come into this scenario where Felix asked Paul to be brought to him for a conversation. Verse 22. But when Felix heard these things, having more accurate knowledge of the way, and that's what Christians were called originally, they were in the way. And it comes because Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Okay? And he adjourned the proceedings and he said, when Lysias, the commander, comes down, I'll make a decision on your case. Verse 23. So he commanded the centurion to keep Paul and to let him have liberty and told him not to forbid his friends to provide for him or visit him. In other words, kind of though he was in prison, he had an open door policy with him. Then verse 24. After some days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, you guys thought she started at 101 Dalmatians, huh? She was around from the book of Acts. She was Jewish. And he sent for Paul and heard him concerning faith in Christ. Now, as Paul reasoned about righteousness, self-control, and judgment to come, Felix was afraid and answered, go away from him. When I have a convenient time, I will call for you. To a church, God says, I've given you an open door. I'm wondering how often we as a church say to that open door opportunity, go away for now. I'll respond when the time is a little more convenient to me. I'm going to do something I rarely do. I'm going to give you all 7 points of the message to start with, all right? Because I'm only going to get to about 2 of them today. But I'm going to give you all 7 of them because I think they're worthy of our thought, all right? So let me just throw these out. Open door people. Open door people are ready. Ready or not. Okay? Do you ever play, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5? Ready or not, here I come. Open door people are ready. Ready or not. Number 2, open door people are unhindered by uncertainty. A little key for those of you taking notes, you won't have to write so fast if you just put ditto marks under open door people. Because each one of these seven thoughts begins with open door people. Okay? So open door people are ready, ready or not. Open door people are unhindered by uncertainty. Number three, open door people are blessed to bless. Number four, open door people resist and persist. When I get back from Africa, I'll get to that one. Open door people have fewer regrets. Have any of you ever had an opportunity before you that you didn't take? Has that ever happened to you? There's something that you had a chance to do something and you just didn't do it. Has that ever happened to anybody else? Okay, well, okay. Have you ever wondered later, what if? What if? Yeah. Often a lot of regrets. Next one. Open door people learn more about themselves. I wonder how Dad felt. I was only nine at the time. I turned 10 in December after we came back. The end of September, the 1st of October from Roswell. I imagine, my dad said all the way back to California, man, I blew that. What am I going to tell everybody who threw a party for us to leave? Cry about us leaving. And now we're coming back. What do we learn about ourselves with what would appear to be failure? I look back now, from hindsight, it's not failure at all, but at the moment, it has that sense and feel to it. And then last of all, open door people are not paralyzed by their imperfections. Just because they don't have everything together in their life doesn't mean we don't walk through the open doors that God provides for us. There's a researcher, her name is Carol Dweck, rather unusual last name. She says it turns out there are two kinds of people in the world. One of them cares a great deal, the other doesn't care much at all. And this, in turn, is connected to whether we are the kind of people likely to go through open doors or not. How much do I care about others? How much do I care about what God would like to do? I wonder which one we are. Dweck realized that kids often face very frustrating times. And she wondered, how do people handle limitation, obstacles, failure, and change? In one study that she took was with a group of 10-year-olds. And she gave each of them increasingly difficult math problems to see how they would handle their failure. Most students got discouraged and depressed, but there were a few that had a totally different response. One kid in the group, in the face of failure, rubbed his hands together, smacked his lips, and said, I love a challenge. And another kid, 10 years old, failing one math problem after another, said, you know, I was hoping this would be informative for me. What is wrong with those kids? Dwight wondered, I always thought they coped with failure or you didn't cope with failure. I never thought there were kids who would love failure. These were alien children. They were probably from Roswell. Dwight realized that not only were these kids not discouraged by failure, they didn't think they were failing. They thought they were learning. So she came to the conclusion that human beings have two different, almost opposite mindsets about life. One of them is what I would call closed-minded set. Those with a closed mindset believe that life is full of a fixed amount of gifts and talents, and their worth depends on how talented they are. Therefore, their job is to convince others that they've got it, whatever it is. If that's the way we think about life, then of course going through open doors is mostly something to be avoided. Because every time there is a challenge, my worth is now on the line. I might not have enough of that it. And I'll try to arrange my life so I always have success and I never fail. I never want to make a mistake, because if I make a mistake, people
people might think I don't have it. Did you ever go to school on a day that you had a test? And did you, I'm sure you did. There's more to that question. And you told everybody before the test, I just did not have time to study for this test. At that age, you probably didn't psychologically think about why you were saying that. But I suggest there are some underlying reasons why we do that. It has to do with it. See, if we tell them that we didn't study, even though we might have, and we fail the test, it's not going to diminish their thoughts about us having the it factor, because you didn't study. It's not surprising. It was a really hard test. And then, if by some chance you did well on the test, everybody's going to think you got more of that it stuff than they thought you had before. So we find ways to manipulate circumstances so that we got it. But there's another way to go through life. Instead of thinking about limited resources, we can have an open mindset. And those with an open mindset believe that what matters is not raw ability. What matters is growth. Growth is always possible. A commitment to growth means they embrace challenges. So the goal is not trying to look smarter or be more competent than other people. The goal is to grow beyond where we are today. Therefore, failure is indispensable and something to be learned from. All right, in this crowd right here today, we've got some of you in your 20s and some of you in your 90s. I'm not making you all raise your hand, all right? Do you think you could grow in knowledge from today till tomorrow? Every one of you can. I don't care if you're in your 20s or if you're in your 90s. You don't have to stop learning or growing. Ultimately, it is in the context of faith in God that we have the greatest, should have the greatest foundation for an open mindset. The reason I don't have to prove my worth is that I am loved by God no matter what. The reason I can be open to tomorrow is that God is already there. And we as believers need to abandon a closed doorway of looking at God and our lives and ourselves if we are going to respond appropriately to the open doors. Closed door thinking may disguise itself as prudent or filled with common sense, but it's really a refusal to trust God because of fear. Closed door thinking is the way David's brothers saw Goliath. Nobody can fight him. Closed-minded thinking is the Israelites telling two of the 12 spies, Joshua and Caleb, that the enemy is like giants and we are like grasshoppers. It's a rich young ruler who came to Jesus late at night and said, "What must I do to be saved?" And Jesus said, "Sell all that you have, give it to the poor, come and follow me." And the rich young ruler decided that discipleship would be nice, but it's a little overpriced. It's me. Closed-mindedness is me every time I choose hoarding stuff over generosity and giving it away. It's me being silent when I should speak truth and love. It's me when I claim to believe in God, but when he says go, I stay. I think there are a lot of statheists in the church today. I'm going to stay right where I am, where it's comfortable. I'm not going to leave this pew and go over to the Sunday school class and face 5-year-olds. God, they're scary. I would never get on stage and do what these kids did here today. Never. I don't care how many notes I can hear right. I will never do what they do. Did you see how terrified some of them looked looking at you? Next service needs to smile more. I would never think about my place of work as a place of worship. Never.
closed-door thinking looks safe, but it's the most dangerous thinking of all because it leaves God on the other side of the door. And Jesus said, I stand there. And then not, remember Revelation 3:20, that is Jesus not at the heart's door of a non-believer. That is Jesus at the door of the church. I'd love to come in and hang out with you, but you close me out. To be an open door person means to embrace an open mindset, along with a set of disciplines and practices to help us regularly embrace and walk through open doors. Let's look at a couple of characteristics of open door people that make them likely to walk through God's open doors. That's the seven I gave you already. Here, let me highlight the first one. Open door people are ready, ready or not. For people in the church, I think open doors always seem scarier than closed ones. And I think that's opposite of the way we are in the rest of life. You see, in our homes, it's always, as a kid, it's always what's behind the closet door that scares us. It's what's on the outside of the door that scares us. That's why we lock our doors at night. We feel safer behind closed doors. But in the church, as Christians, I think the open doors scare us more than the closed doors. Closed door, I can sit right here where I am, and I can be really, really comfortable. Open door, I don't know where it's going. We never know for sure what will happen when we walk through the open door. When we have big choices to make, like taking a job, making a move, getting into a relationship, having a baby. We all want to know ahead of time what exactly are we getting into. By the way, I didn't know this at this service last week, but I'm going to be a grandpa again. We found that out in the last service last Sunday, all right? Chad came to the last service, sent a picture of Shelby and I never looked at my phone during church. I think it's ungodly, and Shelly did, and that's just a joke, man. Shelly shows me this picture that came through on a text, and it's an ultrasound picture, and I said, oh, that's cool, is that the baby? And she said, we are. I said, whoa, Abraham. No, I looked down, it was Chad, so yeah, so sometime in late July, early August, we're having a baby. All right, back to open doors. We often wonder, well, what are we getting into because we don't know. And often I think it's a good thing we don't know because a lot of time if we knew what we were getting into, we wouldn't go through the open door for sure. Just about every parent I've ever known, when they come home with their first kid, and I think it's the reason that often they want one of their parents with them when they bring the kid home the first time. All right? It's because we're not ready for this! And then that kid grows up, and it's time for the kid to leave home and face the world, and the world is scary, and it's expensive. And the kid says, I don't think I'm ready for this! And the parents say, yes, you are! I gotta be honest, that was not me. What I was, I wasn't ready for them to leave. The last, and I said, no, stay with me a while. There's a whole syndrome around this fear called failure to launch. They did a movie about it, I think. People are often afraid to go through economic independence, vocational direction, relational open doors, because they don't feel ready yet. But the world says, ready or not, here's life. Life, opportunities, challenges, relationships, eventually aging and ultimately dying. All of these have a way of saying, ready or not, here I come. Life's inevitability doesn't mean that preparation is unimportant. I would rather have a brain surgeon who's done it a few times rather than a newbie. I mean, just because he spent last night at Motel 6 is not enough for me most of the time. But feeling ready is not the ultimate criteria for determining the places that we will go. God says, I have set before you an open door. Not, I have set before you a finished script. An open door is a beginning, it's an opportunity, but there's no guaranteed ending. It's not a sneak peek at the finish. You can't go to the last chapter and see how it's been written. If it is to be entered, it can be entered only by faith. Feeling ready, quite frankly, folks, is highly overrated. God is looking for obedience. When God brought the people out of the promised land, he had them step into the Jordan first. They had to, by faith, make the step. Maybe the greatest open door in the Bible comes at the end of the Gospel of Matthew. Jesus sends his disciples out to change the world, but there's two striking problems at this moment. One is, there's now only 11 disciples. All through the Gospel, it's always 12. Representative of the 12 tribes of Israel. 12 is the number of wholeness, completeness, readiness in the Bible. Now they don't have enough players. We just don't have enough. But it's not that they have the wrong number only. Verse 17 of Matthew 28 says, when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. They had a quantity problem, not enough people. Now they have a quality problem, not enough faith. New Testament scholar Dale Bruner writes, the number 11 limps. It's not like the perfect number 12, the church that Jesus sends into the world. It's 11-ish. It's imperfect. It's fallible. And yet, this is the group Jesus chooses to change the world. And he doesn't say, hey, let's get enough numbers here first. He doesn't say, let's get enough faith. He just says, you go. Go and do all the world. We'll work on the faith thing and the numbers thing while you're doing the obedience thing. I'm sending you out, ready or not. In the Bible, when God calls someone to do something, rarely does anybody respond by saying, I'm ready. Somebody gave me a good name, and I'll share it with you in just a moment as we wrap this up. But think about some of the key players in biblical history. Moses, Exodus 4. God, you can't use me. I'm not very eloquent. I stutter. Gideon. God wanted to be general of the army, and Gideon said, I can't save Israel. I'm the youngest in my family. I'm the weakest in my tribe. I'm sorry, I can't do it. Abraham, will a son be born to a man who's 100 years old? Jeremiah, sovereign Lord, I'm too young for this job. Too young, too old? God said, no way. Isaiah, I'm a man of unclean lips. Esther, if I go before the king, there's only one law. He'll kill me. Rich young ruler, he was sad because he had great wealth. Ruth, there was famine in the land. Do you always notice that every time God shows up, people want to run? In the last service, somebody told me at the end of the service, hey, Samuel didn't make an excuse. Samuel said, hear my word. Hear mine. Yeah, he did. But that was only after three visits to Eli saying, what do you want? He didn't recognize God's voice. He thought it was Eli wanting to do something around the temple. Finally, he realized it was God. Ready comes faster if we're already moving. Jesus doesn't say, go, you are ready. He says, go, and I'll go with you. What matters isn't whether we're ready. What matters is he's ready. Let me wrap this up with just a thought or two on the second point. Open door people are unhindered by uncertainty. You see, one of the big problems of open doors is that they're not always well marked. When God does call, the call may not always be clear. As a general rule with God, information is given on a need-to-know basis, and God is the one who decides when and where and how we need to know. Classic example comes in the book of Acts. The church has to decide if God is calling them to include Gentiles into their worship. After a lot of prayer and a lot of argument within the members of the congregation, Acts 15:28 says, they sent out a letter to all the churches. It seems good to the Holy Spirit and to us. How do you like that for clarity? It seems good. I mean, the future of the entire human race is at stake, and the best they can do is it seems. And yet the church leaders were comfortable sending out this letter. God could have put an ad on Craigslist that said, now accepting Gentile applicants. That would have been much more comforting, but apparently his will for his people was that they should not be told exactly what his will was. He knew they would grow more if they had to think and argue and debate it out rather than getting a memo. You see, the church was willing to settle for sincere obedience. And I think God wishes the church today would settle for sincere obedience. Go when he says, go. There's always two parts to the command go. Go from and go to. It's always there. Go from and go to. Here's the challenge. Sometimes he doesn't tell us where the go-to is when he tells us to go from. That was Abraham. When God said, Abram, I want you to leave Ur of the Chaldeans, the most classy spot on the face of the earth, and I want you to go. And Abram said, okay, God, well, where do you want me to go? When you get there, I'll show you. That's open door. Faith that God is big enough to get us where he sends us and to care for us in the process. Whether it's across the street, across the hallway, across the office, God places in front of every one of his children, everyone, I don't care how young or how old you are, he places an open door for us to be used by him to do things beyond our wildest imagination. Do you think those 11 disciples thought we would still be talking about them 2,100 years later? They changed the world. And it wasn't a once and done thing for God. He's been doing it again and again and again in the history of his world. And he'd like to use us to do it again. Let's pray. Our Father, I don't think Christopher Columbus had any idea what he was asking the Queen when he wanted to sail around the world. He had really no idea the world was round. And oh, what an adventure he had. And we still talk about him. The disciples had no idea. In a conversation with their king, when he said, go, how history would record about their going. But God, your words are not just for past times. They are for the here and now. Give us enough wisdom. May we want enough of your wisdom to walk through the open door without having to know what's on the other side, except for the fact you are there and you are leading. May we be in for the adventure of our lives, no matter how young or how old. And may we learn from trusting you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So go!